actually intervening in specific locations. So we've got that intelligence, and that's what we're going to be using over the coming months. So the positives there is that we've, you know, against that context, we think that we're going to really be able to drive recycling rates in that very direct approach with residents.
Christina?
Can we ask questions on the appendix one? Well, first of all, on page 29, residents who stay there regularly volunteer support has gone down. But I understand that this company does random checks for these figures. So how do we know that the people that they picked are people who could be people who aren't in a position to volunteer for whatever reason? They don't have the time or they don't have the inclination. So what does that actually mean in terms of what we gain from it? Because it's, again, I feel it's meaningless. I keep saying this. But these things might be interesting, but we can't base anything on them because they're fairly meaningless. And the other one is on page 36, when you look at the number of fixed penalty notices issued, and we've got better and worse, is it worse if you don't issue as many because you're not getting the income? Or is it better if you're not issuing so many because people are realising you shouldn't drop litter? Or is it worse because you haven't caught them dropping the litter? So there's three options there. And on the dog fouling, a similar question.
Okay, so just in terms of the number of residents volunteering, so my understanding is that indicator is based on the Wirral residents survey that we did. So the idea here is we've gone out as a council partners, we've done extensive surveys, it's seen as being a representative sample, and one of the things we're trying to do as a council partners is understand over time the extent to which we get people to volunteer and increase that. So that's where that comes from.
The point I'm making is, which we all understand what we're doing, but the point I'm making, Mark, is if you on one of your surveys with these people in Rubber Council going out to get their intelligence, whatever we're getting, if you randomly pick these people, which is what I'm told you do, because I keep questioning this report, you may well get a lot of people who, for whatever reason, cannot volunteer in a particular cohort, which will show a set of circumstances, which next year you may get a completely different cohort of people. You might get a whole pile of people who've got all the time in the world and love to pass on knowledge. You don't know what you're getting because you say it's random. So what I'm saying to you is, this might be interesting, but the people you asked this year don't volunteer as much as the people you asked last year, but it doesn't indicate that less people are volunteering. The only way you can find that out is to go to everywhere where there's a volunteer and say, have you got as many volunteers as you did last year? That would be the only way of doing it, wouldn't it?
A couple of observations. So there's a number of surveys that we do, either the resident survey or the local surveys, that are based on the same principle of, on a year-by-year basis, you will inevitably end up surveying different people. What the experts and people like Ipsos Moricum can say is, it's this relevance having a statistically representative sample. Well, you're absolutely right.
You have a representative sample, you then don't make assumptions on it and base your policy on it, which is what I'm frightened you're doing.
The whole, through you, Chair, the whole basis of the resident survey and most of the survey work that's done nationally, I think he's done in that kind of a way, as I understand.
Well, yeah, it's meaningless. So you take a different meaning from the fact. You answer the next one on jobs and litter, because that's, I'm curious.
Yeah, so very, very simply here, in terms of environmental enforcement for littering, FPNs, dog fouling, etc., it is absolutely the case that over the time, what does success look like? We want that to be a reduction in enforcement action taking place. So that's what success will look like in a few years' time. We will ultimately see reductions, and that would be a good thing as we get behaviour change.
Right, could you tell me then, sorry to go back to that, does that reduction, the other side of it is somebody checking that rubbish isn't increasing and dog fouling isn't increasing? Because if you just didn't issue them... Yeah, exactly. It could be that everything increases again. You've got to do it both ways, haven't you? And I'm sure you are doing it. I'd like you to ensure that you will be doing it.
Yes, we will, Chair.
Okay, thank you. Steve, Chris, thank you. Yeah, I just take points with Adam's quote from the last press release I seen from Phil Bryant was quite clear. The targets set are now national targets via EU, which is now going to try and British law. And he's quite clear in his perception that the people of Quiddle are to be asked to do more if the, you know, any issues around that, and there's a capital cost to increasing recycling levels, then there should be equivalent grants associated with it. And he's made it quite clear that in the current austerity circumstances, he is that the next source of money for recycling is put firmly at the government's door. And I think that's a fairly sensible view. They set new targets, don't give you the resources to do it, then inevitability is something else falls off, because austerity sticks in Britain, it might not stick elsewhere if you look in Ireland, but in Britain it sticks, austerity sticks, the policy is austerity, and so it repeats itself. I think you quoted his latest press release. His press release is quite clear where he sees the money and the next big move is for government to actually finance local authorities to take that next big step. I think that's a very sensible policy to
take. Thank you. Chris?
My question is going to be again about waste management. Our previous cabinet member before Phil Bryant, I remember saying the statement that, you know, I'm just trying to paraphrase what she said now, I think it was, we cannot do nothing.
Do nothing's not an option.
Okay. And my question would be, are we saying then that the change that we're doing nothing now, which was an option before, is because the finances are on there? So if it was all down to finance, what was the option?
What this is about, and that press release and that's now, is absolutely the response to boost our recycling rates. So it's the, we're not doing nothing. We are taking this very seriously, and we are doing something about it. In terms of the quotes from the previous cabinet member, the context might have been around the fact that if the money can be found to launch a new food waste system, and if that funding can be found, one of the benefits is that it gives us a very significant quick increase to get us to those targets. Undoubtedly, it's more difficult and it's more challenging to do and takes longer to do, to obviously get to our recycling rates using other measures, but we're absolutely not doing nothing. We're getting on, we've got an exciting plan for the coming year.
Sorry, Chair, could I just respond quickly? In that case, I agree with you, Mark, and thanks for that answer. In that case, could you tell us, would you agree with me then that the money we spent on looking into putting in these new bins and these food bins would be better spent on educating the people who do not put bins out?
The work we've done so far as officers looking at the feasibility of that new system was done from within existing resources within the council from the existing officer team.
Okay, thank you.
Ian?
Thanks, Chair.
Just on page 32,
sticking with the issue of domestic waste performance, I remember what we did call it before, page 22, former cabinet member, prior to Councillor Whitehead, was quite specific in the presentation, as Councillor Cruikshank said, about doing it and not doing it. There was nothing in her presentation that we ran forward that said it was dependent upon getting a grant from a third party in a couple of main boroughs. There was no mention of that in the original proposal that was agreed by cabinet. So now to say that we need £1.5 or £3 million capital from the government, it seems to be, I'm not clear what the council's policy is at the moment on food waste. Are we waiting for somebody somewhere to come up with a grant of £3 million, and are we still working on a proposal to introduce food waste recycling? Or have we accepted that it's not going to happen, and so we're looking at alternatives? Because, as I recall from a previous environment committee meeting, the recycling targets dipped in this borough, specifically at the time when garden waste charges came in. Specifically, 70,000 houses stopped subscribing or stopped using the garden waste service. With the result, there was less tonnage being collected of garden waste, which affected the recycling targets. And these were the questions that were asked at the calling on proposals to have food waste recycling. So I'm not clear where the capital all of a sudden has come from, because that wasn't mentioned on the original cabinet decision.
All I can say now, Chair, we obviously have, we have clarity about food waste, that service, the costs, the financial implications of doing it. The simple fact is, as per the press statement that has been published recently, we're doing everything we can around recycling. So this isn't an either or. This is, we're actively pursuing. If we can secure the money, so we have an affordability issue, if we can secure the money from central government or from sources to pay for a food waste collection service, then that would help us deliver our environmental objectives, and that's something that as a council would be absolutely, we would be looking to pursue, I would suggest. And at the same time, whether that happens or not, we're actively pursuing all of the other plans that we can come up with. So these are, these other things are things that weren't developed at the time of the previous cabinet member. All of these new ideas that we've been working on to use things like local intelligence and the resources we have on the ground to drive our recycling rates anyway with in the best way that we can. So we're looking at pursuing both of those avenues.
So from the
analysis
that we've had the recycling, because time's going, you can see less single-use plastics, that's becoming safer than all of us. The original cabinet decision, are we saying that we as an authority are still working on a proposal to have food waste recycling, subject to getting the money for the capital cost of the scheme? Is that what we're saying?
I'm trying to give a direct answer, not be it's good. So what we are saying is, we are, the issue we have, as highlighted by our cabinet member, is that there is a scheme and approach that would enable us to deliver our environmental objectives and dramatically increase recycling. The issue that we've got is that we don't have the money to do that, so there's an affordability issue at the moment. If we can pursue that money from a source, then clearly that's something as a council we'd look to actively pursue to deliver our environmental objectives.
Get a government minister to criticise us at the top of the hat, but you can't get a government to do not a single job.
That's a financial issue last year.
Let's go to all the council facts. When Mark said about getting funding, does that also include looking at bits to our own capital programme?
So, through you, Chair, the scheme requires capital and revenue investment. So, it would require in the region of £3 million of one-off capital resource to be actually buying all these bins for such a scheme. And then there'd be the revenue cost of running the scheme on an ongoing basis. It would certainly be in the region of about £1.8 million. So significant sums of money, both revenue and capital, and they present a significant affordability issue for the council, as I understand it.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
It's on page 22, and I just want to mention about community safety and the 10% reduction in antisocial behaviour in incidents and that. But first of all, before I do sort of comment on that, can I say thank you in particular to Mark Cameron and the interim manager Caroline Hooper from the antisocial behaviour team. What I'm saying that is already from about January the 2nd for a period of about 6 to 8 weeks in Upton, we had absolutely awful antisocial behaviour. Quite a lot of it was down my road and surrounding areas. For example, three houses were broken into, a car was stolen, taken around Birkenhead and that. Other cars were smashed and that. And I was working quite closely with the police, but I have to say the police were not visible and it took quite a while. And it was only when I managed to talk to Mark and Caroline that we did get a meeting after about 6 to 8 weeks with about 40 to 50 residents in that. What I'm saying is this, you know, the incidents might be down, but there just seem to be pockets where this happens and without any reason for it. And I think it was to do with about 4 to 8 individuals who were causing massive problems and obviously focused on that. In the middle of the village, there was a hairdresser's broken into, someone else's bungalow with it, along Church Road, which is this side St. Mary's Church. So we had all those incidents, and we got the whole lot of them. And it was only when Caroline came along to that meeting, and I think she was really helpful in that, and gave all these numbers, or police numbers, that we should contact them down. And you would have thought, well, I'm on the police and crime panel, and I did try to push that, but I do feel there's a total lack of policing, visible policing, in the area. And I think it's been taken up to a certain extent by the antisocial behaviour team, but again, the few and far between. What I'm saying is this, that it's awful for people. Most of the people who live down my road are in their 70s or in surrounding areas, and they're afraid to open their doors in the evening now. And I have to go around and reassure everyone that, you know, we don't want vigilantes coming in looking after areas and that. But I just hope that isn't an indicator of future problems, because, you know, of the police station is closed, and, you know, all those kind of things are happening. But again, thank you to Mark, thank you to Caroline for what the local authority have done in regards to that, but it's still an ongoing problem.
Sorry to bring it back to the recycling again. just to be clear, when waste goes, when, you know, non-recycled waste goes to landfill, we get charged. So we get charged per ton. So as well as obviously the environmental impacts of recycling, there's also a financial impact that if we don't recycle, we get charged for our landfill costs. So any recycling scheme, as well as having environmental benefits, also has financial benefits that the landfill charges that we reduce. So surely some of these schemes will have financial benefit as well as the cost, the revenue cost. So was there work done on what the actual offset would be? And overall, would it be cost neutral, or would there be a charge? Or would it actually be a saving in actually having these extra services in? So obviously, yes, we've got to spend the capital, and yes, there might be revenue, but obviously there's a decrease in the rental charges. So that means, you know, the calculation needs to be clear as to what the end result would be.
Okay, thank you. One of the real positives is that the waste on Merseyside and Liverpool City region, we have through the Merseyside Waste Disposal Authority, we have a resource recovery contract. We have a major multi-million pound contract with CETA, and the waste that goes into your residual bin largely goes to an energy from waste plant up on Teesside. So the real positive is that the days of significant waste going to landfill are behind us now, and certainly as a city region, we've got a state-of-the-art disposal contracting facilities managing that, which is a real positive from an environmental point of view. One of the factors, you're absolutely right, one of the factors that that we do need to take into account is the relative differences in the cost of recyclates and dealing with recyclates and recyclate markets and waste going to residual waste to a plant such as that. And that has been a factor. One of the factors is that certainly for the contract we have here on Merseyside, it's actually a very, very cost-effective, competitive contract, one of the cheapest in the country. So that invariably does affect the business case for rolling out recycling schemes. If we look at other metropolitan areas, such as Greater Manchester, some of the authorities in areas such as that, they've been able to develop a more compelling business case for introducing schemes because the cost of disposal in Greater Manchester is much higher. So that is a factor that we have taken into account.
Chris.
Okay. Thank you, Chair. I just wanted to make a comment to follow on from Councillor Tony Smith. You talked about the policing areas and what time, when that timescale was that you had those problems that you were involved. I know in Eastern and South Wales, we've had a real spate of car theft and stuff. I was actually sitting in Bevington Police Station last Friday with the antisocial teams there discussing what was happening in my ward and how we came around. And what they told me was that they managed to capture 6 or 7 people who were a team of people going and doing most of these crimes. They got people about 75% of the car thefts. The irritating thing for me is yesterday another car got stolen in Eastern last night. Although it's got a lot to do with it, it's still going on. And my concern is I would like to see, as you say, that police station's closing. I'm stuck for the Police and Crime Commission. My concerns were there aren't enough feet on the street, there's not enough PCSOs in the streets. I would love to see more of them. I don't want Steve in the station. But I would love to see some more of them. I'm finished here. And I would like to see this committee to do with community safety. I would like to see a report from the police, Merseyside Police, and what their plans are now. They've had some additional funding for police officers and what it means to us here on the road.
Could I just ask members if they can agree for the chair to rearrange the committee meeting on the 28th of March 2019 because it falls in paragraph and then we get restricted. So is that okay?
I'll have you back on
the recommendation for the first meeting on the list. Okay. Is everyone happy with the work programme?
Possible budget items as a
with the additional items. Yeah. Okay. There's no other urgent items. Thanks very much for everyone attending. Committee now closed. It's over. I wish everyone the best in your actions.